On this day, March 8th, every year, women across the world are invited to celebrate their achievements, and men are also called upon to applaud their progress. Women more celebrate their successes than lament their crosses. We hear about progress, not regress. It's all about accentuating the positive and decelerating the negatives. That essentially is how International Women's Day has been observed here and everywhere else since 1975, when it first started. But four decades later, is there need for change? If the world is changing as fast as the earth is turning, if climate change is a reality today that was never thought of 40 years ago, and if things have changed positively in general for women here and the world over, then things must have also changed in terms of what women are struggling to achieve today and for tomorrow and for the years to come. There were the usual statements today of solidarity and acclaim, but while every activity must be encouraged, there is always a need to constantly review achievements to date before determining demands for tomorrow or thereafter. There's been a qualitative change in what women are demanding today vis-a-vis yesteryear. Back then, the fight here was for equal rights, for same pay for women as men, for pregnant teachers to be able to keep their jobs after delivery, for the woman's right to file for divorce, for delinquent fathers to be made to contribute to the single parent mother's cost of raising their children, for protection of women against domestic violence and sexual abuse, and for men to accept that women do have equal rights. Today, while success has been scored on all these fronts, there are, however, other comparatively new elements in the demands being made today by today's liberated women. They continue to press for erasing from our statute books those laws that discriminate against women. They identify the imbalances in societal gender relations. They demand equal access to upward mobility at the workplace. They show that they are more than makers of children and minders of homes. Women today are leading governments and businesses, working for themselves and matching men toe to toe. Many are also successful single-parent family leaders. Women fly to space, fight wars, captain ships, and women invent medicines, create computer games, and do almost everything a man can do. Today, women are breaking the glass ceiling here, there, and everywhere. Yet, it's also true to say that today's liberated women are pushing the envelope much further than many men, and indeed many women as well, feel comfortable about. Whether for religious, cultural, or other reasons, they will oppose some of the demands of the liberated ladies, but it's not because they simply don't understand. The fact is, not all men and women want to respect a woman's right to be a lesbian. Not all women will support calls for church and state to recognize same-sex marriages. Not all women will want a register of sex offenders. All rights being demanded are right or considered to be legitimate and necessary. But the advocates and policymakers also need to understand why these differences exist before addressing them. Women who don't support lesbianism or same-sex marriages are often criticized by some of the advocates. But it isn't because they're backward and stupid or because their churches have so poisoned their brains. The fact is, like I said, that each of these women and all the men who think likewise do have an equal right not to support what they do not want to support. Of course, they can be canvassed. But where they refuse to budge, they ought not to be railroaded or dismissed as being simply backward. Young women today have different perspectives on what women should be struggling for or aiming for or striving to achieve. They want more than just a good husband, a good salary, and a good education. They prefer to remain single and childless for as long as they have to. But they are also more adventurous. They will do and say things their parents and grandparents would never even think or have ever thought of. There are those who simply don't care. But there are also those willing to listen and listen to the rallying call, and more who are prepared to engage in discussion on what women really want today. And if we take time off to talk to them, then you might just learn a thing or two you never would have thought of just because of the age gap. The women who churn at the sight of the images of young women here on the net or in magazine centerfolds must understand that these young women aren't stripping and posing nude or near nude just for the money or just for the kicks or because they have no self-esteem or because they devalue their bodies. No. A young woman in England made world headlines and got international acclaim when she disclosed last Christmas that she posed nude for photos for 1 year to buy her child's Christmas gifts. And there will always be men who believe that sexual attraction is all part of the species that we share, and that some women are just more sexy to their eyes than others, no matter what anybody else is think, you or I or anybody else. Yes, the issues have changed, and so must the debate. But the quality of the debate just has to improve as well, and it has to improve considerably. I heard a man say this morning that God has to be a woman because only a woman could make a son. And another man said, women about to render men useless because scientists have just discovered a way to make women make children without men. Naturally, I laughed. But these were St. Lucian men calling a radio station to say exactly what they truly believe. Unfortunately, there are many, many men, here and elsewhere, who think and talk just the same. They too, and indeed all men in any society, are crucial to the equation. Reversing the traditional gender imbalance will be impossible here or anywhere else without men and all women understanding and accepting that need for the balance. But there will also always be women and men, and women too, who don't believe men and women are made to be equal. Achieving gender balance and social equality for women is much more than just social engineering. Even in those countries, near and far, where women have broken the gender barrier in parliament, the cause of women isn't easier advanced nationally, as men are still in the majority in those parliaments. And the societal imbalances are institutionally entrenched. Those women and men who haven't come around to supporting the more radical demands of today's liberated women do not all need to be targeted with mind-changing strategies and tactics. They know what they want and what they don't want. What is needed is for the debate to continue year-round and not only on or about International Women's Day. We need to discuss women's issues with both men and women in mind. And most of all, tolerance is an absolute essential. Not only must we agree to disagree, but we must also stop agreeing to forever disagree with someone for just disagreeing with us once, even on a fundamental issue. As one colleague noted somewhere today, women deserve all the respect that civilized men show each other. And I'll add, likewise, the opposite. That said, let's work towards more and better discussion of women's and men's issues between International Women's Day at the beginning of the year and International Men's Day towards the end of each year, every year. That, I think, will be a bright beginning. For Country Commentary, I'm Earl Bousquet.